Good morning and welcome to the 24th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2024. The first item on the agenda is consideration of whether we take item 8 in private. Item 8 is the consideration of the evidence we will hear today on the UK Passenger Railway Service Public Ownership Bill. Do we agree to take this matter in private? We do. Therefore, it will be taken in private. The second item on our agenda this morning is consideration of a legislative consent memorandum, or LCM, on the Passenger Railway Services Public Ownership Bill. I welcome Fiona Hislop, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport for the Scottish Government, and I also welcome Scottish Government officials joining us today. Jan Spry, who's from the Scottish Government, Bill Reeve, who's the Director of Rail, and Fiona Brittle, who is the Senior Rail Policy Manager for Transport Scotland. Good morning to you all. Cabinet Secretary, I believe you want to make a brief opening statement.
Indeed, and thank you, Convener, and good morning, committee members, again. Thank you for inviting me to discuss the Legislative Consent Memorandum for the UK Government's Passenger Railway Services Public Ownership Bill. So I welcome the objectives of the bill as introduced, and I recommend that the Scottish Parliament gives legislative consent to it. The bill represents an important development which this government has long advocated for, the shift of rail services back into public ownership across all of the UK. The bill aligns with the Scottish Government's policy aims and objectives for a fully publicly owned railway to deliver for the people of Scotland and to achieve our vision of a reliable, resilient, affordable and accessible railway. Now, as you may be aware, the Scottish Government has already sought to achieve that for ScotRail and the Caledonian Sleeper Services. So as far as is possible within the current legislative framework, which is reserved. In 2022, an operator of last resort deployment brought ScotRail and then Caledonian Sleeper Services into public ownership and control. Now, our duty to provide or secure the provision of services under Section 30 of the Railways Act 1993 was engaged, and these are now delivered through arrangements with our wholly owned company, Scottish Rail Holdings Limited, and its subsidiaries. Now, these Scottish arrangements already align with the proposed UK bill, and amendments to Section 30 will mean they can continue on an ongoing basis. Achieving that and ensuring Scottish devolved and policy interests are protected has been my key priority with this bill. So officials' extensive engagement with the UK's government's Department for Transport and Scottish Rail Holdings has allowed us to consider and take an informed view of the policy intent of the bill since July, and I thank them for that. I welcome the willingness of the UK Government Secretary to engage with me and Transport Ministers from the other devolved governments on this bill, and in particular the close working among our officials. The bill allows services to be delivered by a public sector company as the first choice option rather than the last resort. It allows current public sector delivery arrangements to be permanent, providing a stable network from which we can continue to provide reliable, affordable, attractive services. This bill amends the Railways Act 1993, replacing the presumption that rail passenger services should be delivered by franchises with a presumption that will be brought into public ownership when current franchise agreements end. It expects franchising authorities, including the Scottish ministers, to provide or secure the provision of designated services under the duty at Section 30 of the Railways Act 1993, currently known as Operator of Last Resort. The Scottish Government considers the bill engages the legislative consent process as modifications to the Railways Act 1993 alter the executive competence. The bill removes the power to award franchise agreements and the requirement to publish a statement on how that power will be exercised. It proposes a new duty to designate services which ought to be provided under Section 30. It prohibits extending existing franchise agreements or agreeing new ones, although the UK Secretary of State, the only franchising authority still to have franchise agreements in place, will have a temporary power to make short-term further awards or extensions to incumbent franchisees in certain circumstances. The bill amends Section 30 so the duty exists on an ongoing basis and not only where no franchise agreement is in place in respect of the services. Franchising authorities may secure the provision of services to fulfil this duty only by directly awarding a contract to a public sector company which can be a wholly owned company. Finally, convener, I have an important rail-related announcement I would want to update the committee directly on, which will be made via a GIQ this morning, and it would be remiss of me not to use this morning's opportunity to do so. I'm announcing today that the Scottish Government has agreed to ScotRail moving to replace the intercity high-speed train fleet, which currently operates between Glasgow, Edinburgh, Aberdeen and Inverness. Over 4 million passenger journeys were made on intercity trains in the last year, and I want to maintain and, where possible, increase that number. So this planned investment will ensure the reliability of our intercity routes for the long term, will reduce emissions from intercity services and will support our efforts to decarbonise Scotland's railways. The contract notice will be published in a few weeks, and I will update, of course, the committee of the progress of that. In the meantime, thank you for inviting me to discuss the legislative consent memorandum for the UK Government's Passenger Railway Services Public Ownership Bill, and I'm happy to answer questions on that. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Interesting announcement. I'm sure members will consider questions that they want to put on that when they come to the end of the first lot of questions that we'd already discussed. So, and I need to apologise. It was remiss of me when welcoming the government officials not to welcome one of our colleagues to the committee, Graham Simpson, who will be asking questions at the end. So please accept my apologies for ignoring you. You were not ignored. And Douglas Lumsden is going to get the first question. Douglas.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. First question I have is around, obviously we know that ScotRail and Caledonian Sleeper are already in public ownership, but do you have any concerns that the legislation coming through is actually forcing Scottish ministers to always consider public ownership first, and it's taken away the right of the Scottish Government to actually move services to into a public company, private company?
Well, it's a policy decision of the Scottish Government that our preference is public ownership. Similarly, it is the preference of the UK government and the new incoming UK government to do that. I think there were obviously continuing concerns over the last UK government as to whether public ownership indeed was the right way forward in any case. Obviously, different governments at different times can make decisions about what their policy priority is. This one aligns with the Scottish government, which is why we're saying that we want to give consent to it. It would be up to, therefore, a future UK government, bearing in mind this isn't a reserved area, which is why, you know, we have to make sure that our powers, which we have utilised to our best under devolution, can be protected, and that's what we're currently doing. The current rail service operation, as I've tried to indicate in my opening remarks, is on a more temporary basis. This puts it on a more permanent basis. But I think your point is about any future Scottish government, and you know, should they make a decision to do otherwise. And in terms of that, my understanding, and I might bring Bill in about the technicality of this, of how the UK government has framed the position. They've framed it so currently it's a presumption in favour of franchising with an exemption for, you know, operator of last resort, which we have used. And actually what this legislation is doing is flipping that so that it's a presumption that there will be public ownership. It doesn't preclude a private company operating at some point in the future, but it is by there's a period where there would be a designation that would allow government to make that decision at some point in the future if they chose to. So that's how my interpretation of how the UK has framed it. And it's an interplay particularly between Clause 24 and Clause 30 as to how that would operate. But it is quite technical how they're doing it. They're leaving a window open. They haven't closed it completely, is how I would, in sort of layman's term, interpret that. But perhaps, Bill, you could explain the technical ways and what they're doing, and also correct me if I've misrepresented that.
I think you're exactly right, Cabinet Secretary. I will also turn to Jan, if I may, for any particular legal detail we need to explore. But there is a provision under Section 24 of the Act as proposed that would allow the Cabinet Secretary to designate an exemption from services which are covered by the Section 30 process, or Section 30 presumption of public ownership. that wouldn't remove the need for any alternative arrangement to be subject to the various procurement rules that may be enforced at the time. And it's not, I think, at this stage clear to us how that would be exercised. And as a matter of policy, it's not something, I think, that we would choose to exercise. Jan, is there anything you'd want to add to that?
Raise that well, thank you.
It's just to maybe follow up slightly. So you're right, Cabinet Secretary. It is a policy decision at present. It's a preference of the Scottish Government that I completely respect. But is it not the case that that's actually that ability to do something different is actually going to be taken away by what's coming through here? And is it, you know, we have a Scottish Government. They've got the ability and right to make decisions on Scotland's railway. And that is being eroded slightly by what's coming through here.
Well, you might say that the UK Conservative government eroded the option of UK governments of the future to have public ownership. That's what they did when they, you know, privatised and the railways. You know, that's what they did. And obviously, it's open to any UK government to overturn that in the future. And that's exactly what this incoming UK government could do. In terms of the section, I think this is important. It's to try and obviously, I'm interpreting the UK legislation. It's not our preference. It's not our policy. We believe public ownership is the right way forward. That is why we took the steps that we did. We were the first to do that. I think in recognition, the UK government are now catching up to the position that we've been in. But if it helps, I found that the section that I think may help you to get some reassurance if at some point, unlikely point, that a government came into Scotland that might want to do something different. Are the options there? Our understanding of this is, remember, this is what the UK have put in, is that the bill amends section 23 so that Scottish ministers will have a duty from time to time to designate services that ought to be provided under section 30 rather than under a franchise agreement. It will also amend section 24, as I referred to, so that the Scottish ministers could exempt services from such designation and allow for them to be provided otherwise than under section 30. Now, this is very technical, but this is what we understand they've done in this area. If services were exempt from designation by order, the duty at section 30 would not apply and the Scottish ministers could make alternative arrangements to secure the provision, which could potentially include a contract award to a private operator. That's our understanding of what the UK government has done to leave that, as I said, that window. It's not our preference, but the provision is there in the legislation.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. Convener.
Cabinet Secretary, just before we go on, you made an announcement which I truthfully need a moment to consider. What would be very helpful, I don't know if it's possible, is for you to share what you read out with the committee clerks now so it can be circulated to committee members while they're considering their other questions, so they can have a look at it, because I truthfully didn't catch all the ramifications of what you just said.
So I'm happy to do that if we can find a technical way of doing that. I'm sure my office is watching this, and we can find a way.
Yes. Well. Okay. Fine. Thank you for pointing that out to me. As you can imagine, I don't have time to look at the computer while I'm trying to convene this meeting. Now I know there's a GIQ. The clerks will make sure that the committee members get that. I apologise for that interruption, and thank you for pointing it out.
Can I also say, I have utmost respect, as you know, for the Parliament, and actually it's always been open for ministers to make announcements.
Do you know, Cabinet Secretary, I'm delighted that you chose the committee to do it, and I'm not criticising you for it. Right. All I'm trying to do is, while I'm trying to convene the meeting, I'm listening to what you're saying, what other members are saying, and it would be helpful to have it in front of me. So I now can have that, so that's perfect.
Excellent.
Please don't take that as a criticism. Monica, you wanted to ask a question.
Yeah, and I'll maybe come back to questions at the end then about the announcement.
Yes, please.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I think in your helpful opening statement, you were really clear that this facilitates policy alignment between the Scottish Government and the UK Government, and I think that was positive and it was well understood. I wonder if you can just say a little bit more about ScotRail and the Caledonia Sleeper services and how the Scottish Government envisions that publicly owned cross-border railway services will interact or work alongside those? For example, are there any downsides or any impacts that need to be mitigated, or overall does it feel like a positive measure?
So obviously any rail disruption causes issues and problems for commuters, as we all know. We haven't had the same degree of industrial action as has happened over the last number of years in England, which has caused, I think, the majority of that cross-border problems. And the interaction with cross-border problems, whether it's industrial action or indeed the problems I experienced on Sunday with LNER, and it looked as if everybody from Waverley that was going south to London had to turn up at Haymarket, so that was rather congested. But that, breakdowns happen, and that happened to me. That's my understanding of what happened there. So some of these issues will be on an operational level, but in terms of what I hope will happen is a degree of stability within the system. I think finalising pay negotiations, which I'm very pleased that the rail unions are recommending a referendum to accept the Scottish pay offer, and I understand similarly in the rest of the UK there's an attempt to do that as well, which is again welcome. So I think there's a combination of a number of different things. Public ownership of it in and of itself, I think in Scotland has stabilised our relations with the trade unions. They've said it's been in a much better place since we've had public ownership. We could then project, would that be the same with the UK government? Well, I would hope so, but obviously we haven't seen that yet, so the evidence of that. I think the other benefits of public ownership is you're focusing on passenger service delivery as opposed to companies seeking profit, and that allows reinvestment in the service. I think what's quite telling with public ownership by the Scottish Government is we've seen the employment of 400 additional staff members since public ownership, and a lot of that is public front-facing, public safety, the safety teams, etc. It includes 260 new drivers, and there are currently another 160 drivers currently being recruited. Now, there's always a challenge to replace drivers. People retire, there are other companies to work for, etc. But in terms of making sure, therefore, that we're not dependent on overtime and rest day working, mm-hmm. I think that would be a good common interest to try and achieve, one, because it's the right thing to do, but also it means that should the withdrawal of those, trade union members are perfectly entitled to do, is not to work on rest day or overtime. If there can be more stability in the system, I think that would really help everybody. So it means you're not having to have temporary timetables, as we've seen. And I think the major disruption by actual strike action in the rest of the UK had knock-on effects. So I think it's quite complex. I'm not going to assume that public ownership will suddenly resolve everything and everything will be okay. Some of it will be at operational level, but it depends on the attitude and behaviour, I think, of the employers to the workforce, but also in terms of government. There's many challenges ahead, and there always is, as I've now obviously realised, taking on the transport brief. But does that give you
That's helpful. And I'll just remind the committee of my register of interest, because I'm a member of the RMT parliamentary group. But Cabinet Secretary, you talked about the importance of investing in the workforce, having good industrial relations, and that helps with passenger safety and passenger experience. So from your early discussions with your UK government counterparts, are you feeling more optimistic that there can be that stability and, I suppose, a policy approach and a goodwill towards the workforce that we can see, hopefully, an improved picture across the railways, not just in Scotland, but across GB?
Well, there's much to do. I've met with Louise Hague, and because, obviously, the Parliament was in recess, and again, I'd like to thank the Parliament authorities and indeed the committee and the committee clerks and cooperation for bringing this LCM, because obviously we had to do this at pace over summer, and I didn't want us to be left out of this, which could have happened. Mm-hmm. And that's why I'm very appreciative of my own officials, but also of the UK government officials. I'm working with the Minister to try and align something that's happened when we don't align necessarily in a parliamentary term. So that's been good cooperation. I haven't met the new UK Rail Minister yet, Sir Peter Hendy, although I did meet him in his previous position as chair of Network Rail, but I hope and intend to do so.
Thank you.
Okay, Monica, thank you. Jackie, your question might have been answered, I fear. So I'm happy to move on to the next one, if you're happy to allow me to do that. OK, perfect. The Deputy Convener's got some questions. Ben.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You've touched on this already, about the engagement that you and your officials have had with UK officials and also with UK ministers. And it seems like it's very positive and good in intergovernmental relations on this bill. But I just wondered if there'd been any further discussion with them on possible wider reform of the British rail industry. And obviously the Scottish Government is a leader in the renationalisation of our railways. Is there anything that the UK Government is learning from Scotland, perhaps?
Well, they are indeed, and it started, to be fair, under the Conservative government, was that proposal to integrate track and train. Scotland's already done that. We work very well between Network Rail and ScotRail. It provides efficiencies in terms of investment and also in terms of that planning operation. It also, and I've visited their control centre in terms of the multiple storms that we had, remember, last year, in terms of how we react to when there are major disruptions that are weather-related. So that integration of track and train is a positive step forward. You'll be aware that the last UK government seconded Alex Hines into the Department of Transport to work on what was the then rail reform legislation. I gave evidence on that. I guess shared my evidence with the committee. Obviously, it's a step forward for for England and Wales. I have got concerns how that might operate in Scotland, and obviously the incoming UK Labour government have picked up the baton on this, and our understanding is that they will take forward what will be a more substantial piece of legislation, which will be the formation of GB Rail. Now, that's the one that I think certainly the committee should take a close interest in. I certainly am as a Cabinet Secretary, because what we don't want to see is a complete centralisation that would actually undermine the progress that we've made in terms of integrating track and train. Now, we want to operate and cooperate in a positive way forward with this. I already had communicated some of my concerns to the then chair of Network Rail, Sir Peter Henty, who's the new UK Rail Minister, so he should be familiar with some of the concerns. And so therefore the issues that I had and I expressed when I gave evidence to the UK Transport Select Committee at the time, I think it was just before the close of the last UK Parliament, those concerns still stand. So we have yet to see, obviously, the substance of what that is. I think with that level and the attitude of cooperation that we've engendered today, I would hope to see that there would be a very practical way forward to ensure that my concerns are addressed. But obviously, there's more to do. So obviously, this bill is a very short, sharp. It's about end of franchisees and into public ownership. But the more substantive rail reform legislation is still to come. And obviously, we'll need to keep a close eye on that when it is published. But in advance of that, I would hope that the relationships that we've built to date would stand us in good stead, both at official level, but also at ministerial level, to try and make sure that our interests in Scotland are protected.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. Just looking around the table, Mark, I think I cut you off because you might have wanted to come in on an earlier question, but you're happy that you...
I could just come back briefly.
Yes.
I mean, I'm also interested in that wider picture of rail reform, Cabinet Secretary, and I'm just wondering sort of where that's at the moment. I mean, there's been a very good first start with this particular bill, improving relations between the two governments and hopefully across devolved administrations in the UK government, but where do you see the next most substantial reform setting up a GB Rail, the kind of timeframes for that coming through, and do you see the Scottish Government being directly involved in the governance of that? Is there a clear model for how devolved administrations will be involved in that going forward?
The clear model is for rail services to be devolved fully to Scotland, and that is what I will continue to put forward and set out. I've already stated that in my meeting with the new UK Secretary of State for Transport. I think that would be the right way forward for Labour. If they recognise devolution, they recognise that Scotland has been leading in a lot of the policy direction that they want to go in. It would be a shame, and I think a retrograde, if they weren't then to follow through with that understanding that you can have devolved operated transport services well to such an extent that they actually want to copy it for the rest of the UK. In doing so, if they then centralised it, that would be problematic. So I would like to see the full devolution of rail services. We are, I think, to be fair to the UK government, the new incoming UK government, it's early doors. They're focusing on this immediate piece of legislation. But I do hope that the atmosphere and the windows are there to have an understanding of that. And I would hope with Alex Hines, seconded into the UK Department of Transport, there would be an understanding right at the centre of the UK government of the position of Scotland and the opportunity. But I'm not sure, Bill, whether at official level there has been to date discussions on what the likely timescales are for the next phase of that GB Rail establishment.
I think at the moment we don't have firm dates for the next step. We know that there is a rail reform bill to follow. I would characterise the discussions with our UK government colleagues as constructive and perhaps a little more open even since in recent weeks and months. And we look forward to cooperating with them on that rail reform bill. But at the moment, we have seen no substantive provisions from them on how the issue of devolution alongside rail reform will be treated. Clearly a matter under consideration. And we have clearly asked for and expect to secure the opportunity to be engaged in those discussions to help shape that in a satisfactory manner.
OK, thanks. That's useful. And can I just ask an issue about open access operators as well? So the likes of Lumo and Grand Union and these companies that are sort of coming in and kind of, I guess, sort of utilising space within the rail network. Will that continue or will effectively those open access contracts?
Again, we have yet to see the specific provisions that any rail reform bill may contain. I think from discussions it's our expectation that existing operations would be permitted to continue, but until we see the details, I couldn't answer that definitively.
And I think that's going to be a challenge, but even looking at the LCM-related legislation as to what the time frame when franchises might come to an end, because this is not like a full-scale nationalisation on day one, etc. This is going to be a rolling issue. But in relation to the wider issue of that GB rail reform, I'm very conscious this committee has got a really full agenda, and obviously your interest in this will be similar, I'm assuming, to our interest in this. So I undertake that we will keep in close contact with the convener and the clerks so that what we know about timescales for scrutiny and engagement can be aligned with, so that you can take the opportunity, as we will, to make sure that our interests are protected in Scotland.
Do you have a view on the open access operators, or would you rather see the entire rail network brought under
I think there's an underutilisation of the potential of what we've got in our railways, and there's different ways of trying to resolve it. I think there's far more that can be done on freight. I'm very, very keen to do that. Under CP7, we've got strong targets. I'm glad the UK has also got strong targets under CP7, but actually trying to utilise our rail tracks there's lots of moving parts with this, not least in terms of what's electrified, what's not, what does that mean in terms of speed, etc. But obviously it doesn't help when you've got some operators cutting services, cross-border cutting services to Scotland, and actually as we've seen more recently, sometimes some of the from an open access that space has been filled. So I think it is I think we've got to watch where things are going more from a UK basis. Anything else on that?
I've just been reminded with respect to the timing of the legislation that we're currently told an introduction into Parliament before the summer recess next year in Westminster. We have no more detail than that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I've got a couple of questions, Cabinet Secretary. I think the example of Lumo is quite an interesting one because a lot of people benefit from being able to get reduced fares from an operator coming in from outside, but I'm sure you'll bear that in mind. My question really relates around the round robin of how money goes. So Network Rail gets money from train operating companies. I think it's about £2.1 billion a year goes into Network Rail's budget, which then helps finance rail track, and freight, I think, puts in about £58 million in there. Now, if you take the train operating companies out, I assume they will be no longer making, well, they won't be making contributions, so the money will have to come from the government to go into Network Rail. So what I'm really interested in is this whole process of, and I know you will probably answer, Cabinet Secretary, that the government gives money to private operators to run the services, but are you convinced that this isn't going to lead to increased costs for running the track, which at the moment is contributed considerably, over 50%, I would say, of Network Rail's budget from private operators? Are you happy that we're not going to see the railway lines decrease?
So I cannot speak for the UK government. What I can do is speak to our experience over the last period. Remember, it's quite a short period of public ownership. And with the establishment of Scottish Rail Holdings, with our pressing down on spend, we've managed to reduce costs, actually, rather than have costs increase. We've seen substantial passenger increases. Now, from 46, in terms of the kind of... I'll look at the figures. I'm trying to relate them. But anyway, so since COVID, the figures have increased substantially. But in terms of Scotland, we are our satisfaction levels are one of the third, fourth highest in the rest of the UK. That has increased. The latest satisfaction was at 91%. There's things that are happening under our public ownership that shows that both in cost and also satisfaction and also performance went down, but we know that because obviously during COVID it was, things were more efficient because there were fewer passengers, etc. So I think our experience to date would indicate the public ownership has benefits
I don't want to get into whether public ownership has benefits. What is slightly concerning me is that the PPMs for ScotRail have gone down, and a lot of that is placed on problems south of the border with trains coming up late. That's the excuse that we're given, despite the fact the service has been cut. What I want to be sure in my mind is that reducing the amount of money that's available from private companies into Network Rail isn't going to increase that, and it isn't going to affect the Caledonian Sleeper, which is going to use rails south of the border to provide the service. Are you convinced there's not going to be an increased cross or a diminution of the tracks south of the border?
I'm going to bring Bill Reeves in on this as well. However, what I can say is in terms of our investment in Network Rail, using our current system, and remember this is the first control period 7 that we're going into with public ownership within our system, that certainly in terms of the investment of Network Rail, it has gone up substantially. We have got a pipeline of activity and works, so that investment is there. In terms of what you're probably trying to get at is the displacement of funding that comes from the private companies and how that is operated by the government. I can give you evidence of what we've done, and we are the trailblazers in this area because we've done it for the last 2 years. I cannot speak for what the new incoming UK government would do. That would be speculation. And I can say from our evidence that that should be positive, but I can't give you firm commitments because I'm not responsible for their decisions on that. But Bill, can you enlighten us on that specific point about the private train operators' investment?
Well, specifically with respect to the cost of the infrastructure delivered by Network Rail, the efficient cost for that is determined independently by the Office of Rail and Road through the 5-year control period process. How that cost is met, I think, is what you're touching on. There are two principal sources. One is direct grant from government, including the Scottish Government for Scottish infrastructure. The other is track access charges. There's a small contribution to the track access charges from freight companies.
£58 million.
Indeed. There's a small contribution from open access operators,
quite really very small contribution. But the rest comes from franchises or Section 30 operated, publicly owned operators. And to be honest, it's a bit of a trade-off whether that gets funded through the franchise contract from a combination of revenue and franchise payments from government, or whether that's done through the direct grant. So I think the answer to your question is to focus on the efficiency of delivery of Network Rail rather than how those costs are funded. I'm not sure I've seen much in the mechanism of funding that has driven that efficiency, as distinct from the relentless focus on the efficiency of delivery of that work.
But I can undertake to make sure that that point is made to the UK ministers as to can they identify that that will happen. And on the more substantive point, which is how do we get efficiency out of Network Rail and how we deliver the value for money for the £4.2 billion over the next CP7 being contributed by the Scottish Government, I've already made arrangements with the ORR to meet them on a bi-yearly basis, and I will be meeting with their board to ensure that they ensure that Network Rail, because they are the regulators to ensure we're getting the value for what we've got and the delivery. That is a substantive mechanism to ensure that Network Rail is delivering. And I have, if anything, intensified my discussions with ORR.
Okay. I mean, I think the point I've made is that I want to know that the costs are going to be met and what the true costs are, and it's not going to affect services in Scotland in any shape or form, because in the past we've heard that poor railway maintenance or the network maintenance has resulted in reduced services in Scotland. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you'll work on that. Graham, do you want to ask any questions on this bit before we go on to the announcement that the Cabinet Secretary made?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I just want to go back to Mark Ruskell's. Is that okay?
Yes.
Yeah. Mark Ruskell was asking about the open access operators like Lumo, and I wasn't clear from your answer whether you actually think that sort of arrangement should continue.
I mean, I'm fairly open on open access, if that makes sense. I think, and because I do think that there are times when and opportunities that haven't been necessarily fulfilled, I think it puts a challenge on the main operators to make sure that they've got better services. However, I think that's more going to be an issue for the UK government, because most of those services are ones that are cross-border that are coming through. So therefore, I think that is an area that, you know, again, as this bill progresses through the House of Commons and the committees there, it will be subject to that. So I think they currently operate, even though we have public ownership, you know, in Scotland. But that's primarily, obviously, because of the arrangements that the UK government take. I think we have the space for that. I don't think it's problematic. However, it depends the extent of it and scale of it and whether it's seen as, you know a few companies doing that on occasion as opposed to full rollout of open access, continuing, etc. So I think the issue is more for the UK government on that, but obviously we'll keep a keen interest in it.
Well, it comes down to track capacity, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So, from your answer there, can I take it that you actually quite like the choice that this offers customers?
I think it's still to be assessed the impact of it. And you know, it's there. I'm kind of I see it's operating. I've got no difficulty with it. I just think it's not the main issue that we're dealing with just now. And I think, my first answer was quite clear, that I think where there are opportunities in terms of track access, that's worked, and it has actually replaced services that have been withdrawn actually in many cases. But it's a different operating model. It's a different pricing model. It's a different position, and they can do that for particular reasons. It's not an area that I've had discussions with the UK government about, so I'm not, you know, I'm just saying the jury's out on it a bit. But I think the way it's operated today, I think, has helped use track availability that was there.
Yeah. Okay. And you spoke earlier about your wish to see rail be fully devolved. What exactly do you mean by that?
Well, it means that in terms of that operation of track and train, it's fully determined and decisions fully decided by the UK government currently still, and it is under the Rail Act 1993, issues still have to then be referred or approved or agreed by the Secretary of State, UK Secretary of State. And that was the real problem we had with the last few Conservative government's real reform legislation, is that even if we wanted to make a decision about franchising or not franchising or other areas, we would have to seek permission from the UK Secretary of State to do that. So it is about making and you know, making more permanent the powers that we have. And obviously, you know, that's a discussion that I'll continue to have with the UK Secretary of State as their second piece, their major piece of legislation on the GB real reform comes through.
But this legislation that the committee is considering today actually, and we go back to what Douglas Lumsden's line of questioning, actually tells the Scottish Government and the Welsh Government what it has to do. So if you were to, you know, if a future Scottish Government was to say, well, we actually think we need to have a different model, there is a piece of legislation that says, no, You have to do this as your first option. Now, surely, as someone who has spoken passionately about devolution, that tramples all over devolution, does it not?
So we either deal with where we are just now, or we determine that we, in terms of fighting on principle of decision making, that somehow we want to try and cause a fight from this. And, you know, it is the case that rail legislation remains reserved. While rail legislation remains reserved, and that's why I'm referring to the main piece of UK legislation that's coming and our opportunity to have full devolution there, but while UK rail legislation remains reserved, and I have the opportunity to ensure what is a temporary system of public ownerships becomes a permanent system of public ownership, I am going to take it. And I think that's important that we take that opportunity. I could have just said, well, that's it, it's the summer recess. They can get on with it. At some point in the future, we'll try and get some changes down the line. But you know yourselves, when you have an opportunity for UK legislation, or indeed Scottish legislation, to deliver the policy output that you want, you take the opportunity. And that's why, while UK rail legislation remains reserved, I want to make sure the Scottish interest is protected, and the Scottish interest is protected by us recommending to Parliament to approve the, with legislative consent, the opportunity to make sure that the temporary public ownership of rail becomes permanent.
But that's because you agree with
I still am the convener. I'm going to let you have one more question and the final part of it, and then I'm moving on. So,
one more.
Yeah, this one you're asking now.
Thanks, convener. I think that this is because you agree with the policy of the current UK government. I am talking about a future Scottish government taking a different view. And this legislation says, oh, no. You must do nationalisation. Now, I think, knowing you as I do, in the past, you would have been jumping up and down about that if the previous UK government had attempted.
So, just on that note, I look forward to.
I'll let you come back, Cabinet Secretary, and then I'm going to move on to the very important question that was asked by Jackie Dunbar before the committee raised, which allowed you to make your statement.
If I can, I'd like to address a point that I look forward to Graham Simpson agreeing with the Scottish Government and voting with the Scottish Government. I'm assuming if we bring this to Parliament, that rail services should be fully devolved, which would always enable governments of any colour in the Scottish Parliament deciding themselves what they want in terms of policy in rail. So I'm looking forward to that support.
Nicely put, Minister. Let's just move on to the announcement that you made to the committee this morning. And I reiterate, I think I'm delighted that you've made that to the committee. I just want to make sure committee members have a chance to ask questions. Douglas Lumsden's indicated he wanted to, and Bob Norris. So Douglas Lumsden.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Just on the announcement, Cabinet Secretary, is there any sort of timescales on the replacement of the HST or the Intercity 125 trains? Obviously, they're going to be 50 years old next year. And in the written answer, you've also said the decision follows a process of appraisal to look at different options to replace the trains. So can you give us a bit more information on that, whether they're going to be diesel, whether they're going to be electric or hybrid? What are you actually going to be purchasing?
So I think it's important because I've actually been asked in this committee before about replacement of high-speed trains, and we've taken the decision that that ScotRail can go forward in terms of the procurement. They're going to run an open competition for the replacement of trains, so it's not possible to say what type of trains that will be. That will be set out when they run that competition. The requirement will be for a train of an intercity type to serve long-distance travellers with corresponding levels of passenger comfort and passenger amenities. It will, in terms of the timing of that, again, it's the procurement will start in terms of the issues of the contract details for the procurement in the next few weeks. So as a result of the procurement, there will be determination of what type of train it will be. It will certainly, in terms of our carbon reductions, where that's what we want to achieve, the extent of electrification required, for example, will be determined by the outcome of the procurement exercise. But I think importantly to reassure you that the cost of infrastructure to support the replacement is part of our financial planning. So we've worked closely with the Exchequer and finance officials to ensure that potential capital requirements are understood. So the type of train, as I said, will be determined by the outcome of the procurement exercise. Any modern train will be cleaner and greener than its predecessor. And for those that have asked questions in this chamber before, particularly about the comfort and experience of passengers, that also will be improved. So what I can give a commitment to, and I have done in, I think, my correspondence with the committee, is that we will keep you updated on the progress, which will then give you some indication of the timeline. But we're at the start of this process. I thought it was important to come to the committee and let you know that that process has now started, and we'll keep you updated, and that will give you the answers you probably want as to when, where, etc. But let the procurement exercise start.
But in terms, sorry, Cabinet Secretary, in terms of the appraisal that's already been done, what has that shown, and will that be released to this committee?
Well, in terms of that's obviously in terms of assessment to help us in terms of making sure that we've got our finances in position, capable and able of dealing with what the potential procurement may be. So, you know, that exercise has been done. Our job now is to let ScotRail get on with the procurement, and that's what I'm announcing to Parliament is now going to happen.
But sorry, on the appraisal, will the committee get to see the?
I'm not sure. That's. I mean, can I take that back? Okay. And think through that, Douglas.
Thank you, Douglas. Bob, you wanted to come in, and then Monica.
Just a couple of very brief questions, Cabinet Secretary. First of all, check that this announcement today is set in the context of the strategy in 2022, which was the Scottish Government's commitment to replace 65% of the train fleet and 675 carriages were. That was placed on the Public Scotland website at that time. So is this announcement part of that wider modernisation, decarbonisation process?
Right, so the other thing to let the committee know is that obviously we've got the new climate change plan, which obviously the committee will consider. As I've told you before, we'll obviously have to refresh the decarbonisation plan, which we will do, and it will come shortly after the climate change plan, because obviously we've got to align that with the climate change plan. So in terms of where we are just now, in terms of that, you know, passengers, I can't get into the detailed carriages as yet. If there's anything I can follow up on where this sits within that particular 2022 commitment, happy to do so. But in terms of where this does sit in within our wider plans for Scottish Rail, we're already, as I said, doing the, you know, we've got Barrhead electrified, we've got East Kilbride work commencing, that will have an interchange, etc. There are obviously, you know, challenges elsewhere. We need to try and ensure 75% of passenger journeys are currently on electric trains, which is good. But in terms of that number, you're talking about number of trains, etc. We've already, again, there's an interplay here. Since public ownership, we've got 7% more increase in passenger seats, and also in terms of journeys, 200 operating to full timetable, which currently I acknowledge we're not.
I mean, that's helpful. I mean, there was an announcement in 2022 that 65% of Scotland's train fleet would be replaced as part of modernisation and decarbonisation. I suppose I was just trying to check whether this is part of that wider commitment. I mean, happy to get more information at a later date, Cabinet Secretary. But, I mean, the second thing I want to know is about that procurement process. And I mean, clearly, I want to make sure that Scottish companies can be part of that procurement supply chain. And as I've done before, I would note that I'm delighted that the Cali has reopened in Springburn and is now in the business of modernising and building trains by Gibson Engineering. And it's just to make sure that Scottish companies, wherever they are in Scotland, can be part of this huge economic and employment and skills opportunity to get a slice of that very welcome announcement. So will the procurement process make sure that there's a weighting towards Scottish supply chain businesses as part of it?
So it will be an open procurement. It will want to ensure we can have value for money and will deliver what we need in terms of passenger track and train. Obviously, I don't want to comment on any individual company, as you might appreciate.
Of course, absolutely.
I don't think that would be appropriate, particularly as we're about to move into procurement. But I think everyone's heard what you've had to say there, and I'm sure there'll be a lot of sympathy to what you've had to say by many people in the public.
Okay, thank you.
Monica.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, you say that the announcement provides a path towards a decarbonised intercity network, and in your statement you talked about the potential for a reduction in emissions from intercity services. I wonder if you can advise the committee by how much in terms of emission reductions. What does the modelling say on that?
Any replacement would need to ensure that it's supporting a greener fleet. You know, I think that's one of the kind of clear points I want to make. However, it is an open procurement, so I can't say that until the procurement is concluded. So if you can appreciate that. So that's that's my commitment. But in terms of by how much, I can't say that because obviously they're only just starting on that procurement.
Okay, but you're confident there will be a reduction in emissions as a result of this investment?
Yes, that's part of our requirement.
Okay, and just briefly, just building on Bob Dorris's questions about the supply chain, I think around sort of community wealth building to make sure that investment benefits people and communities in Scotland. How does this announcement today fit with the Scottish Government's wider aspirations and commitments around just transition to make sure that investment in green transport and good jobs for the climate, will this make a significant contribution, do you expect?
Well, because any investment in rail is good for the rail industries. In fact, going from here and at lunchtime speaking to RIA, the Rail Industries Association, they obviously represent a number of companies based in Scotland, Scottish companies or international companies based in Scotland. And so therefore our approach to rail is actually looked at with envy actually from other parts of the UK, because we have had that constant pipeline of whether it's track or train in terms of that procurement area, and obviously there's supply companies in all of that firmament. And I think as part of our contribution to the economic well-being of Scotland, we very much want to see that progress. Also jobs and apprentices and the skill base, everything that's within that. So that's all part of how we see the rail industry in Scotland. The rail industry in Scotland and the rail provision in Scotland is not just about providing passenger transport core that is, it's that economic, social and environmental impact it can also have. So we do look at things in the round, so it's within that context. And, obviously working closely with rail unions as well in that regard.
Mr Simpson, one question from you.
One question, how many trains are we talking about?
So the open procurement will establish what is the optimum requirement in terms of the delivery of these trains. Obviously, you've got, in terms of that, your point about improvement in passenger service that I talked about. But obviously, that the contract details will be established in the coming weeks from ScotRail that will be published.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I have a final question at the end. I mean, obviously, this is good news as far as it reads, but my concern is the two most difficult railway lines are from, if you want to be simple, from Perth or up to Aberdeen and up to Inverness, which would cost a massive amount of money to electrify. I mean, we've seen the cost of electrification from Glasgow to Edinburgh. And those are the two lines that need the most investment and need the most change because they're using diesel trains to chug up there. Surely anyone, if it's an open contract, will go for the easy option. And yet again, Aberdeen and Inverness will be left on the sidelines with the old trains. Or will you ensure that won't happen?
Well, the operation of Inverness, Aberdeen, Dundee and kind of north, say Aberdeen to Edinburgh. So I think in terms of looking at our four cities, the importance is that those lines are all supported. And I understand it's 25 trains that are being replaced. Graeme, I've been helpfully indicated that that's the number.
I hope you're right. I would say that Inverness has often been the last one to get the investment, whether it be road or rail. So we'll be interested. But thank you for making that announcement in the committee, and thank you for answering our questions this morning. And I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of panels. So thank you very much, and I suspend the meeting. Okay, welcome back to the committee meeting. Just to say, I apologise, Cabinet Secretary, we are running a wee bit late just on the basis of the fact that another item was added to the agenda in the last session, so I apologise. And just on that note, say to people, if we can keep our questions short, I might be able to get us back on time. So item three is consideration of a draft statutory instrument, the Environmental Protection Single-Use Vape Scotland Regulations 2024. And I welcome Gillian Martin, the Acting Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Energy. Thank you for making yourself available for this session and for those that follow this morning, Cabinet Secretary. Also welcome from the Scottish Government, David McPhee, the Deputy Director of the Circular Economy, Mark Sweeney, the Senior Policy Advisor for Product Stewardship, and Carolyn Boyd, who is a lawyer. Thank you all for coming. The instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means it cannot come into force unless the Parliament approves it. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to recommend that the instrument be approved. I remind everyone that Scottish Government officials will be able to speak during this item, but not in the debate that follows. Cabinet Secretary, I think you want to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. I will keep it brief. Thank you for the invitation to give you evidence this morning. We want to ban the sale and supply of single-use vapes to make our communities greener and healthier. Research commissioned by the Scottish Government found that up to 26 million disposable vapes are consumed in Scotland in just 1 year, along with 801,000 tonnes of packaging. And of these vapes, an estimated 10% were littered and more than half were incorrectly disposed of. It's not just a problem in Scotland, however. Across the UK, 73% of vapers say that they throw away single-use vapes, and this is far from the circular economy that we're all trying to build. The lost lithium alone is the equivalent of 5,000 electric vehicle batteries worth of lithium that's thrown away every year, and 5 million single-use vapes are thrown away every week in the UK. One of the single-use vapes that are returned to shop or recycling centres, it's estimated that only 1% of them are actually recycled due to the complexity of recycling these items. Batteries and electricals, including vapes, have been responsible also for approximately 700 fires in bin lorries and at recycling centres in the UK, and that impact's been felt keenly in Scotland. This year, 54% of vape users under 18 said that a single-use vape was the vaping device they use most frequently, so clearly action needs to be taken. So that's why in last year's programme for government, we committed to take action to tackle the environmental impact of single-use vapes. We've consulted on the policy proposal, the draft regulations and impact assessments. We have worked very closely with respective governments across the UK to align our policies. We've laid the draft regulations before you today in keeping with our commitments. So the instrument before you is the Environmental Protection and Single-Use Vape Scotland Regulations 2024. And if passed by this Parliament, it will ban the sale and supply of single-use vapes in the course of business in Scotland from the 1st of April 2025. And the date was agreed with other UK nations who are also implementing a ban. We're the first to lay regulations for this policy, and each nation will bring their own legislation in due course. The ban will, of course, reduce waste and numbers of single-use vapes littered, tackle our throwaway culture by encouraging more sustainable behaviour. We've worked very closely with Trading Standards to ensure that they have the necessary powers to enforce the regulations, reflecting their feedback through our various consultations, and we'll continue to work closely with them as we move forward to implementation. So in conclusion, Convener, from litter on our streets to the risk of fires on waste facilities, single-use vapes are an increasing issue for our environment, local communities and young people. This instrument is a crucial step in tackling their environmental impact, and I urge you to support it. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Jackie, I think you want to head off with the first question.
Yes, thank you and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Again, I think my first question is probably answered, but is there anything further you'd like to add about as to why the Scottish Government feels it's important to implement this regulation, especially just now?
Well, if we want to take single-use vapes or the sort of disposable vapes, as opposed to the probably better known, out of the economy altogether, because for a number of reasons there's not the ability to recycle them, even if they were to even make it to recycling plants. It actually is quite a manual process to actually. They're not designed to be taken apart. They're not designed to be recycled. So by taking, I think I expressed about the volume. I mean, if local authorities were having to recycle these vapes, it would cost them like £200 million. So by taking them out of the equation completely, there's a number of kind of like, you know, advantages to that. The first is they're not going to be littered in our streets, and I think everyone here will have noticed in the last few years, once you spot one of them in the street, you're spotting 10 of them in the street. You know, they, even when they go into a bin, they are, you know, they're going in with this sort of general rubbish. And of course, I mentioned there's lithium in there. Now, lithium is a very precious resource. We're often talking about the fact that there's not enough lithium available for the larger batteries that we need for EVs. They, you know, cumulatively, they have got a great amount of lithium in them as well, which is just ending up in the general waste. So I think it's going to be, it's also going to have a health impact as well, because we do know as well that quite a lot of the uptakers of the single-use vapes are likely to be underage. They are getting hold of them somehow. I mean, that's what teenagers do. They're very attractive. They have flavours associated with them, which is attractive to younger people. I think that by taking them out of circulation, you're less likely to have younger people, underage people, accessing vapes, because they would not be likely to buy a rechargeable and reusable one for so many reasons. So I think there's like a number of advantages. And of course, there have been fires as well associated with them too, because if they're not actually been disposed of properly, then they're likely to go into general waste and cause a fire in a bin lorry. Like I mentioned, there's been so many instances of that happening already. So huge amount of advantages there, not least the impact, and obviously it's an environmental regulations that are bringing through, but they do have, it does reach wider than that into health as well.
Okay. Yeah, I think it's vitally important that we separate the single-use vapes to the vaping products that is used as a smoking cessation tool. Former smoker who used to use the vapes, and so I know the benefits of it. Did I hear you correctly, Cabinet Secretary, that you said that it costs local authorities about £200 million per year?
It would, if we were to put in place that local authorities had to collect and recycle.
Okay.
These types of kind of like disposable vapes, that would be the cost of it.
Okay.
You know, so they're extremely expensive to recycle because, as I say, they're not designed in a way to be taken apart easily. You're effectively going to have a person breaking them open and separating them into their component parts. So by taking them out of the waste equation altogether, then we're getting rid of that difficulty. But I think the thing is that even if we were to recycle them, even if we were to go down the route of like saying that they have to be recycled a certain way, the cost would be huge. But actually, as I mentioned, even the ones that are actually sort of like brought back or put into recycling, only 1% of them was ever really recycled properly anyway, just given the difficulty there is around them. Most of them are going to general waste or been thrown in streets, been thrown in hedgerows, been thrown out of cars.
So sorry, I picked it up wrong and I apologise. So do we know the actual cost to local authorities just now of having these single-use vapes?
I'm not sure if it's quantifiable. I'm going to look to my officials, David.
So I don't have the exact figure for the recycling point, but what we know from our impact assessment
just overall, overall.
So at the moment, most of them are dealt with just through kind of the residual waste, because that's where they're put. Most of them aren't being in that recycling. That's the point. If we were to get the recycling, it'd be expensive to even recycle them. But what we do know from the impact assessment is there's a cost of, there would be a reduction of 7.4 million from reduced fires, for which obviously cost local government as well, and 2.5 million from landfill. So that's just them going into there. To recycle them is very expensive. And one point, if I may just add on about, it's worth noting the exponential growth we've seen in disposable vapes over the last 4 years. So they've grown for a very small base to large numbers that the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, and could grow much, much higher. So the point is that the increasing amount of disposable vapes is an increasing demand on waste services, lost lithium. But if you were to recycle them, which obviously is the hope with all products where it comes to the end of their life, it would be extremely expensive because of the type of products that they are. So there's it's that increasing volume that is also the concern.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener. I appreciate that.
Thank you, Jackie. I've got a few questions. I'll just make an observation at the start, and I think it was interesting, Cabinet Secretary, that you said disposable vapes are often used by underage people. I mean, I've certainly, and I think we've all seen shops where disposable vapes are made attractive to children. Also, those shops selling ice creams to attract people in, and I know of one situation where ice creams were being sold with a disposable vape as a free gift on the side of it, and it is quite evident that there is a problem. So as long as the government accept that this isn't going to absolve them from stopping and encouraging young people who shouldn't be supplied vapes from getting them, I think that's a step forward. I wondered if, Cabinet Secretary, if the definition is flexible enough to allow future-proofing. One of the issues that we've had is raised by us is that the use of coils has been mentioned, but ceramic plates are now used in disposable vapes, and pod vapes are being used. So are you convinced that the legislation is going to stop some clever person getting past the definition in the Act of disposable vapes?
Yeah, there's a number of things in there, Convener, that all four nations have tried to kind of engineer out of the regulations and future-proof these regulations to make sure that the definition that was developed alongside all the other nations take into account that kind of feedback that you've just mentioned. So single-use vapes are going to be are defined in these regulations as products that are not rechargeable or not refillable. So effectively, in order not to be caught by the regulations, the vape has to be rechargeable and refillable. And in order to be considered rechargeable, they have to have a rechargeable battery and separately a replaceable coil. So that seems to be quite kind of narrow a definition as well, which hopefully addresses some of your points. Notwithstanding that, Convener, there is a huge industry associated with the manufacture of these single-use vapes. It's not in the UK. It's usually in China. Is there going to be potentially attempts to sort of re-engineer them in a way that sort of, like, looks at the regulations? Potentially, yes, and we're alive to that fact. The very fact that these are in regulations means that we, as four nations, as we implement this ban, we'll be having to keep a very keen eye on any kind of innovations that effectively works around the regulations that we've had. So we want to be able to sort of like respond to any risks that might arise as maybe that innovation that might happen. But as for the products that are on the market today, that are of the type that we want to take out of the system, the regulations are quite tight in identifying them and what's not a disposable vape as well. To answer the question, the point that Jackie Dunbar made about the fact that for many people, the rechargeable and refillable vapes are part of their journey out of smoking.
Okay, so my question to you is that rechargeable and reusable or extended use, even to the extent that you can do one refill and then it becomes useless, could mean that the vape is cheaper than one that can be refilled numerous times. I don't know. I've never used them. I was a smoker, but yeah. I've never been attracted to vaping. So how do we get rid of that? You know,
Well, I'm not entirely familiar with a reusable device that would only work a couple of times. It seems to me that if you were going to invest in something that, you know, was of a price and a sort of design that was like reusable, you would want something that was going to last. So I think there'll be consumer choice will come into play there. If my officials have anything to add on that, I mean, I'm not entirely sure how you can predict.
Well, I don't.
How a consumer will react.
I don't know, but all I'm saying is that if you get one with a cheap battery that can be recharged a couple of times, or one with an expensive battery that can be recharged 20 times, for example, and I don't know if those figures are even relevant, but the 21 will cost more than the cheap one on a couple of times, and I want to make sure that we're not just moving to that intermediate stage
sure.
where you're throwing something away that meets the definition and it's cheaper. I don't know. David wants to come in.
So Carolyn may want to come in this as well, because Carolyn's closer to the regulations. But just to confirm again, just to reaffirm, we've worked really closely with trading standards and with other nations to make sure that this is as tight as it possibly can be, noting that innovation is almost impossible to kind of future-proof, but or completely future-proof. On your point about devices that could be charged more than once, potentially, you're right, there could be a cost model in there which is cheaper than a fully kind of reusable for a long period and in between, but it would still be more expensive than a disposable one. There's an argument about per use. If you're going to reuse it many times, you get better use per use out of a fully disposable ones. The disposable ones tend to be more attractive, as far as we're aware, to people who essentially are maybe not wanting to recharge it for a variety of reasons. Either they don't want to have to carry it about, or they shouldn't have it. Kind of that type of space. So we think that this definition gives us the best chance to prevent the most voluminous kind of disposable side of it. We can't stop if something is rechargeable and refillable, and there is something in the regulations, and Carolyn may want to talk about it, about the refills have to be readily available as well. It can't be that it's technically refillable, but you have to, you're 6 weeks to get a refillable pouch. It has to be readily refillable to actually be able to do it. So as much as possible, we've reduced the ability. Anything left is, in theory, a reusable vape, even if it's less reusable than the top end.
Okay, I guess my point is went through a stage where, for example, on printers for computers, it was cheaper to buy a new printer than to buy the ink cartridges to go in the printer. So you ended up throwing away a perfectly serviceable printer because it was cheaper to buy a new one with the printer cartridges installed. And I just want to make sure that's not the way this is going.
I think we need to be alive to any kind of modifications that could be to the things that are on the market. And as I said, I think at the beginning, that the four nations have worked together to put a definition together that we think will avoid that kind of situation. But of course, there's some very clever people out there that might see a gap in the market, and we need to be alive to that as we see it implemented.
Okay. Carol, you may want to come in, but Mark wants to come in with a follow-up question. It might be appropriate to bring you in at that
stage.
Yeah,
just on that. I mean, if the manufacturers can bring the price of the rechargeables down to the same price as the disposables, won't people just, buy the rechargeables but continue to chuck them away? And in that case, wouldn't it be more sensible to have, even for the rechargeables, some kind of minimum price associated with it, so we're not just perpetuating the current disposable culture where people have something which is technically rechargeable and refillable, but actually it's so cheap that people are just chucking them away as they are right now.
So I think tax was looked at, taxing them was looked at as an option. I mean, Zero Waste Scotland scoping report looked at that and options to manage the environmental impact of single-use vapes initially. But their report concluded that tax, it might support the policy objectives, but it would have a limited effect if it wasn't sort of tied to waste management outcomes, of course. Any duty on vapes would need to be sort of like, considered on sort of like a round of the sort of people that are accessing them for smoking cessation and the quality impact around that as well. And I mean, I suppose you could argue that the higher the price there is for something, then the less likely people are to actually buy it. But I think we also have to recognise that vaping, although it does have, and it does have health implications as well, because you are still taking nicotine into your bloodstream. And obviously, I'm not health minister, so I won't go into too much detail in it. But the very fact that if you make them too expensive, then for a lot of people that are actually trying to quit smoking and see them as an alternative, you're potentially taking them out. Because vapes are actually, they're not used and prescribed as a smoking cessation tool. They've been brought in by people from manufacturers that's an aid. Most smoking cessation tends to be of the sort of like patches variety or the gums and everything else associated with that as well. So I think in the round the Four Nations thought the regulations around the single use vapes was the best as a first really quite large step in getting rid of the litter problem. But of course, that doesn't stop us from looking at what might happen after the 1st of April in terms of what actual consumer behaviour might change and look like. Convener made that point. Mr. Riscoe, you're making a similar point as well. How might behaviour shift? What might the design of these reusable ones look like? What might be the littering implications of a shift to them as well? Mm. And I think that that's why the sort of the regulations are about single use in the first place. But in the future, I think that we have to monitor how this works, and we need to look at maybe some of the consequences that there might be of the type that you're describing around what happens to the reusable ones. Of course, we are also will be looking at, you know, around all the waste management strategies that are in train now, the Circular Economy Act, as to how we actually dispose of electrical items in general, you know, of which these would be one. So I think that will be taken into account as well. But I think it is going to be an enormous step in actually taking the disposable ones out of our streets, out of our bins, and out of circulation as a first major step.
No, I'd absolutely welcome that. I suppose it's a question about, you know, do you trust the vaping industry, given where it's been, what it's developed into, to work with the spirit of the regulations that are being put in place here and to establish a genuine market for rechargeable, reusable vapes that may have a role in terms of smoking cessation but are not more widely available to a market which is huge and currently growing.
Yeah.
I have my doubts that smart people somewhere won't find a way around this. And price point would...
Yeah, and I think we've all recognised that.
If you were sitting in the boardroom
of a vaping
company, you'd be going, let's go for price point, then we just keep our market alive. Why would we not do that?
So the UK government did, in their consultation, put proposals in about introducing a duty on all vapes. I'm trying to think whether that was a pre-general election commitment, post-general election. We're waiting on the publication of that report and obviously working with counterparts across the UK on what might be the next step. So it's not off the table. Mm-hmm. It's just that we're concentrating on getting the regulations around single-use vapes with an eye to what might happen. And I think actually it's probably, it will inform what we do with regard to any kind of, or inform what the UK government do with regard to any duty on the rechargeable and reusable ones, because if what you're suggesting might happen and what the convener suggests might happen does that there's innovation around it and effectively they're sort of bringing effectively the same kind of costs that people don't value them and look after them and do recharge them and do reuse them, then that will inform some of the conversations we're having around this potential for duty on the reusable vape-type mechanisms in the future.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks. The Deputy Convener's got some questions. Ben.
Thanks, Convener. Just on those points, I mean, I think that we'll also need to keep an eye on what the EU do in this space, because it's when that huge market actually begins to regulate that it could have a significant impact on market change. And perhaps there will be good lessons learned from Scotland and elsewhere that can help in that process.
Yeah.
Out and about in my constituency over the summer, I, you know, visit a lot of small businesses and talk to them about a variety of issues. And of course, the convener mentioned an instance in his experience of learning about or hearing about a business that was perhaps not acting responsibly, but most grocer shops or otherwise who don't just specialise in selling these sorts of products but sell these products as part of a range of other products in their store will be thinking about what this is going to mean for them. And I just wondered if there's some reassurance that you could give in terms of the fact that trade bodies have raised some concerns about, you know, the impact of this on the viability of small retailers, and what engagement has there been to help mitigate any negative impacts in terms of small business that this will have? You know, is the fact that we're considering this now to make sure that there's a, you know, around 6 months of notice for these businesses to clear their shelves, so to speak, of products that are not going to be legal in the spring?
Well, exactly that, Ms. McPherson. You point to the fact that once the regulations pass, it won't be until the 1st of April that they're actually be banned. But there's actually been more notice than that, because the retail industry has known that they've seen the regulations, been the consultation has been out. They've been consulted with as well as part of that process. We've obviously had live consultations. It was in the programme for government last year, of course, that we're... it's been a topic of conversation in this Parliament for quite some time, with many MSPs lobbying for a ban of these for very good reasons. So it's really, I suppose, there's the official kind of notice, like, you know, Parliament agrees these 6 months, you've got 6 months to run down your stock, basically. And there's always going to be impacts associated with not allowing retailers to sell an item that is profitable, right? And there's no getting away from it. These items have, in the last 4 years, when they've sort of exploded onto the scene, I mean, I think from initially just sort of like, you know, in the single digits percentage of people using them, it's gone up to about 50% of people using them. They've become extremely popular. But let's look at the demographic of people that are using them. A lot of them, as the convener said, are younger people. And I'm quite shocked to hear that, you know, with your ice cream, you're getting a vape. My goodness, that brings me back to like almost like the 1980s with the rogue ice cream guy selling you the single cigarette in the match as you went out to get an ice cream. And I think we all recognise that kind of thing that used to happen. I didn't realise it was happening with vapes. So even there, I'm steeped in this. The flavours associated with them mean so that, you know, they are attractive to younger people as well. Now, of course, it's not, I'm not saying that retailers are selling them to younger people. They're doing the same that in time of memoriam, they're getting a guy that's going in for these messages and there's kids outside and they're saying, can you buy me one of these? Or older siblings are buying them, or friends or whatever. Listen, that's just the way teenagers operate. We know that. But I think in terms of the business case, it's like, yes, you're not going to be able to sell this profitable item anymore. So you've got notice to run down your stocks. You obviously can decide whether or not you want to start retailing the reusable ones instead, alongside the refills for them. So that's another stream of income that you might have to service the demand that might come from the people that you suggest, you know, legally buy the single-use vapes, and that was their preferred model. There's going to be a market there for them, and that's for them to make that business decision at all. So just to give you a bit of background, so we contacted every vape retailer in Scotland. We identified them. They're on the tobacco, nicotine and vapour products registered. There's 7,000 retailers registered on that in Scotland. So we contacted them all. We invited them to provide feedback on the draft regulations as part of the development of the BRIA. We conducted the Scottish Firms Impact Test, or the SIFT, and we interviewed 11 businesses that came forward, and we worked with them to about they could be able to put some of the potential impacts it could have on them and work through them. The themes identified were funding for enforcement, potential for illicit sales, you know, get underground kind of thing. And a variety of businesses did respond. And of course, that's not the end of the consultation. Obviously, once the regulations hopefully are approved by the Parliament, we will get in touch with every single 7,000 members of that register to, you know, alert them to the fact, if they've not already seen, that the regulations have been passed as well.
Thank you. I think that engagement will be so important to kind of stakeholder organisations as well. So I welcome that reassurance. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm going to try and encourage committee members and witnesses to give short answers to short questions, just because we are quite pushed for time. So I've got a very short question Minister or Cabinet Secretary, sorry, 1st of April 2025, whole of the United Kingdom or just Scotland?
So, as it stands, we're all going forward as one. We want to go forward as one. Obviously, we've got a new government in place, and I need to make sure that everything is, still in train. Actually writing this week just to get confirmation of the fact, where are the other nations, letting them know that we've laid our regulations and that we've started the process. One of the things around that is that should I get an answer that comes back and says, well, actually, no, we're not ready to go on the 1st of April, then I guess there's a couple of options open to us. We can either, if the period is quite short, we could decide to sort of like change our regulations to come at a date with everyone else. You know, say it's only a couple of months, then I don't think there's any harm in that. I think that, but say it's a couple of years, that's a different question altogether. And I think we would need to think about how we might go forward, because that would be a couple of years of those items still being in the streets, still being in our bins, still causing the problems that they have. So, but as it stands, convener, I have not had confirmation that it has changed the implementation date, but I am. I think I've actually signed off in a letter yesterday, which has gone to the UK government to say, "We're ready for 1st of April. Are you all ready? Is that still the plan?"
I think I would just note my deep concern if we all went forward on different timescales, because it would just mean that there'd be an illicit market which was very easily fueled from elsewhere. So. Probably just leave it at that, Minister, but Cabinet Secretary, I would certainly come back on this whole thing if it wasn't all at the same time. Monica, you had some questions.
Yeah, thanks. I've got a few questions on enforcement issues, but just to sort of pick up on the concerns about underage sales, that's definitely an issue raised with me over the summer in Hamilton and across Lanarkshire. And I know that in her submission in writing to us, Laura Young said that a pitiful number of fines have been given out in comparison to the underage sales we know are happening across Scotland. So with that in mind, I want to ask, how will enforcement of the regulations be enforced, in particular to mitigate the risk of illicit trade? Because we've heard from Laura Young, but also from COSLA and Scots, who are the professional body who represent heads of service in terms of trading standards. They have highlighted that enforcement capacity may be an issue due to resourcing difficulties. So will the Scottish Government make additional resources available to assist with this?
So this is obviously the enforcement of anything that we're bringing in is absolutely crucial. And I think there's the communication that we would have with retailers around what this actually means for them. But they also, 29 out of 32 local authorities were supportive of this proposal, and they obviously have their trading standards officers have the powers already available for any kind of illicit goods been sold. This is adding to the number. But as you remember, Ms Lennon, beyond the enforcement powers they already have and the offence provisions that are in these regulations, the Circular Economy Act amended the regulation powers in the Environmental Protection Act to allow provision enabling enforcement officers to issue fixed penalty notices as an alternative to prosecution for the offences, as a shorter, sharper, more effective way of actually, fining rather than prosecuting in the whole court processes will be a lot more straightforward than some of the processes that they've had to So I think that might release actually a bit of capacity in the system here with regard to them. Obviously, Cabinet Secretary for Finance is the person that you have to ask around any financing for local government. Not really for me to answer that. But I think that there's actually going to probably be, like any ban, there's going to be an initial sort of concentration of activity in this until everyone's used to the fact that they're no longer available. And then it will be a tailing off. They just won't be in the system anymore. And retailers will get used to it. Of course, with all the reporting mechanisms for the public in reporting anyone selling them will be open as well. But I'll leave it at that, Convener.
Thank you. And I'm sure we'll keep an eye on the resourcing issues. Can I also ask, how will the regulations be enforced in respect of illegal sales online or from private dwellings where trading standards officers will not be able to enter? What's the strategy for tackling illicit trade?
Well, the sale of anything online is subject to the same regulations as the sale of anything in our high street. If it's illegal online and it's a UK-based business, then they're subject to the regulations here, so they're breaking the law. If it's online sales, of course, that are coming from outside the UK, then obviously that is there's going to be increased amount of funding from the UK government to sort of like the border force and customs in order to deal with this, because I think they're preparing for the fact that probably will be an issue, not necessarily in the UK, but people will be purchasing them online. So in the same way that you couldn't, I mean, if you purchase something like a sort of dangerous weapon or illegal or pharmaceuticals or whatever, they'd be subject to customs searches. Obviously, they'll be alive to the fact that people might be trying to bring these in out with the country as well, that someone has actually purchased them online. So there's actually going to be more resources put into those mechanisms at UK level.
Okay, thank you. Scots have also made detailed recommendations on enforcement powers, saying that the powers provided in the regulations are restrictive and impractical. So can we get an update on what discussions are happening between the Scottish Government and trading standards officers, particularly those who are running departments in local government, to address these concerns? And, you know, Cabinet Secretary, are you satisfied that the enforcement powers currently put in the regulations are appropriate?
Well, as I mentioned, there's the fixed penalty notice ability now. Obviously, that has been done in concert with Scots as well, about the powers that they need. Basically, what's one of the reasons that we brought it in when we did in the circular economy bill, to give them that extra power as well. If my officials have any more detail in the ongoing discussion with Scots.
So I'll just make one point, if that's okay, just about engagement, and I'll maybe ask Carolyn and Mark to say something about the fixed penalty notices side of things, particularly about bringing them into force. So we engaged with trading standards colleagues immediately, as soon as we announced that there would be a ban, and we spoke to them immediately. They have been heavily involved in drafting the regulations, provided feedback to us. We worked with the regulatory review group, which includes trading standards on there as well, to work with them. So, and we continue to engage with them on the challenges around this. Now, as always is the case, that there may be a desire from trading standard colleagues to go even further in some of these things, but we're sometimes controlled by how far we can push regulations in this space. So we're providing as much powers as we possibly can, including bringing in or potentially intending to bring in the regulations around the fixed penalty notices, which is where I'll hand over to Carolyn in a second. But basically, we continue to have a constructive dialogue with trading standards colleagues on a regular basis about how this will impact, not just on how the regulations play out, but also on that demand that puts on them, around alongside with competing demands of other regulations that are in place as well. We recognise there's trading standards is a particular service which has a lot of pressures on it. So we continue to work with them and other colleagues to understand that. So we have that positive dialogue. And as we move towards implementation, we'd obviously want to work with them to ensure we got guidance right and got pre-engagement with retailers right, to make sure there was understanding of what would be there, and that's factored into our conversations. So in terms of engagement, I think that's what I'd say. But Carolyn or Mark, you want to say
just
anything?
Just before you do, thank you for that, David. I'm just looking again at what Scots have said to the committee. They say that on impact assessments, these do not adequately address the resource implications for local authorities. So I hear, Cabinet Secretary, what you say about the opportunity around fixed penalty notices and the wider framework around circular economy. But it's also important that this concern is not dismissed. So is that going to be, you know, discussed on a continual basis, and finance colleagues need to be brought in? Will that be looked at in a joined up way?
Just building on my answer, if that's okay, just to say that, I mean, we do continue that conversation about the impact of this. There's obviously a flip side to this as well, that kind of, that to some extent, by banning these, it changes the dynamic of what trading standards have to do, because obviously they have to regulate the sale of kind of disposable vapes at the moment. There's also the impact on, that we talked earlier on about the impact of fires and kind of waste, etc., which has cost to local government already. So there's something about understanding the fullest picture in that. But in terms of actual finances, absolutely, we continue that conversation. But it's obviously, as the Cabinet Secretary said, it's a matter for kind of budgets beyond kind of necessarily just this. But we do have those conversations, and we are continuing the conversations about what the rounded impact is for local government and the impact of this. And again, local government, much local government has called for this ban because they know the impact it has as well beyond kind of trading standards, beyond waste and kind of litter, etc. So we're trying to work with them as positively as possible in that space.
Thank you.
So worth adding that following the first consultation on the draft regulations, we updated the definition and also the enforcement powers in response to communications from trading standards. Just to build on David's point, there also are expected savings to local authorities, particularly in waste management, due to reduction in gate fees, litter and cleansing costs, and we estimate those savings to be approximately £10.2 million over 10 years. So that's £7.4 million from reduced fires, £2.5 million from landfill and incineration fees, and £300,000 from litter and cleansing. So there also are savings to be expected as well.
Thank you. I'll hand back.
Monica, Mark Ruskell, I think you've got a question here, or have you...
I do actually, just based on what the Cabinet Secretary was saying earlier on about timescales, and also you're seeking that four-nation approach, you're seeking for all the nations to move at the same time. It sounds like a sensible approach, but if there is a need for discretion in there, given timescales may diverge, do you have an exemption under the UK Internal Market Act to effectively make that decision for Scotland about going first or going later or whatever?
So obviously, new government's in place, and I've written a letter to them asking for confirmation of what the go-live date is going to be for the other three nations as well. So that I've made the point that we don't want to diverge. You know, I think there's very good reasons for us all going ones. Obviously, there's environmental reasons for us all going ones, but some of the issues that have been brought up here are other reasons as well. I've put it like this: if it ends up being a small gap, we would still want to move at the same time as everyone else. If it ends up being years of a gap, that's a completely different question. As well, I'm hopeful it won't be. You know, we've got a new government that comes in. We've had a general election. There's probably been a point where government machines have had to stop to a certain extent, and maybe that might impact. I don't know yet, and I haven't had confirmation of that. It could be that, you know, we're ready to go. That's why I'm laying our regulations, thinking, well, 1st of April was the date that we all agreed. We need to get ready. If other parliaments and other governments are not in that space, and there's a time lag, then we look at our go-live date. Why would we go live 2 months before the rest of the UK? That just wouldn't make sense. So but if it comes off the table, okay. I don't think it will. If it comes off the table, and you know, but I don't think that would be the case. But if it's years of a gap, that's a completely different question.
Okay.
Obviously, if I was told if it was years, I would try and convince them that it can't be years. Thank
you,
Convener.
So if you haven't requested an exemption under the IMA?
No, I'm going to take things as it comes. What I've done is I've asked for clarification first, but I have mentioned the fact that obviously there is this mechanism, but I don't want to have to use it. I want us to go together.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you. Paul, I think you've got a couple of questions.
Just a couple of British questions, Convener. I might just return to enforcement, CABSEC. Under Regulation 9, enforcement officers have got the power to sample and take possession of single-use vapes, and that's quite a precise definition, I understand. The powers are not framed more broadly, such as to seize or sample items or items suspected have been single-use vapes. Just wondering, can you offer some reassurances? Can this be too restrictive a scenario to allow enforcement officers to get and take appropriate action?
I need a bit of clarification on your question, Mr. Dorst. Are you asking about they've got the powers to go in and seize the single-use vapes, but what's the issue that
So they have to identify them, take a sample.
Yeah.
As put to me, Cabinet Secretary, they have to take a sample, identify it as a single-use vape, and then move to seize and confiscate, whereas they couldn't, under the terms of these regulations, they couldn't suspect a batch of single-use vapes to be so and take them all at that point. There could be a delay in the process. Are the powers drawn too narrowly, or do you think enforcement officers could go in, have reasonable suspicions to believe there are boxes upon boxes of single-use vapes, and confiscate them at that point, seize them at that point?
Well, that's my understanding, Mr. Dorris, but maybe my officials might be able to help me. I'm wondering whether are you getting that they might take items that are not single-use by in error, or...?
The converse, actually. Looking at the briefings that I've looked at ahead of today's meeting, there's a possibility that if an enforcement officer is not clear that items are single-use vapes, that they would hesitate and not seize them at that point, whereas if the powers were drawn more broadly, they could seize them, establish that they are single-use vapes at that point, and retain them. Because the definition the regulation understand is single-use vapes and not items suspected to be single-use vapes.
So again, Carolyn is the lawyer and expert on this, but just to reaffirm again, working closely with Trading Standards on this, it's about trying to understand what they... As far as I'm aware, we've not had any concerns from Trading Standards being raised about that. There's lots about the powers of their ability to do things, but not necessarily specifically around that point about not being able to identify that something, that there is an issue to consider. I think they have the powers to be able to kind of work to seize things that are obviously single-use vapes, and where there's an uncertainty, there would be a process they'd have to go through to make that clear, including the sampling, as you say, where it's unclear. I mean, if it's clearly a single-use vape, then there would be no need to sample. It would just be dealt with there and then. Where there would be a debate, they may have to sample and go back and seize. But, Carolyn, is that the reading of... Are you aware of any other conversations with Trading Standards about that element?
I can't speak to conversations with Trading Standards, but I think it's important to distinguish between the different powers. So there is a power to take samples of a single-use vape or components of single-use vapes. Then there's another power to, if in the case of any single-use vapes, the enforcement officer can subject it and subject it to any process or test and dismantle it. And then in the case of any single-use vapes found in the premises that the enforcement officer has entered, they can seize any single-use vapes and retain them for use in evidence and to examine them. So they don't need to take each single-use vape and conduct some sort of scientific process or test to say it's a single-use vape, if you see what I'm saying. If the Trading Standard officer has entered into the premises, there are single-use vapes there. They are empowered to take those single-use vapes.
So I wasn't suggesting that. Rather than be a pedant in relation to this, I think I would just seek an assurance, I think Mr. McPhee gave, that Trading Standards are content that they've got appropriate powers, but government would keep these under review along with Trading Standards and act if there was indeed a gap in the regulation that needed to be plugged.
Of course, I mean, it comes back to the earlier point as well. What if there's something else that enters into the market that looks different or whatever? And obviously, we'll be alive to anything that happens in a foreign nations approach, where that might be the case and might cause any dubiety around them. But I think for the moment, I think the single-use vape or the disposable vape is fairly obviously different. It has a different appearance than the rechargeable type.
Right. OK, I'll leave it at that. I think the important thing is Trading Standards, who will have to enforce this, have said they're content. Mr. McPhee.
Can I just to make clarify, because I never want to kind of put words into somebody else's mouth, we work closely with State Trading Standards on developing these regulations, and as far as I'm aware, they are on that particular element. I have not heard any particular, as mentioned in other briefings, trading standards would maybe prefer even stronger powers in some spaces, but they have been involved in developing the regs, they have commented on the regs, they've come in space. So as far as I'm aware on that specific issue, I'm not aware of any specific point where they were concerned that that would prevent them from doing what had to be done.
I think I was just simply asked then if there's a grey area in relation to that, if the Cabinet Secretary has given a commitment, just to get a wee bit of clarity on that, and once we move into the enforcement stage and this has been passed, that will be kept under review and you'll continue to work with trading standards to see if there are any issues regarding enforcement.
We always do that. When regulations land and once they're enforced, we will be keeping an eye on how they're working, and if there's any issues that come up that have not been considered, then of course we'll look at that again, but it's not been raised. Hence my confusion as to your question. Initially, Mr. Dawes, but hopefully my officials have been able to give you certainty that it's not been an issue.
I think I've got certainty because trading standards are content at the moment, but I think the question is just inspired by there's a lot of technical regulations within the bill, and we've got a lot of expertise within the committee, clerking and spice team, to just identify potential areas where the legislation can be improved, and that's what inspired the question. But moving on, things you also get to learn on this committee, Cabinet Secretary, is what we regulations are, which for the purpose of anyone watching this, I should say, are waste electrical and electronic equipment regulations. And I also note that there's going to be a vaping product duty implemented UK-wide in 2026 as well. The reason I mention that is I would quite like to know about the interaction between these wee regulations, perhaps other potential fiscal measures in relation to these matters, take-back schemes that are still be required in relation to vapes and vaping products, but I understand compliance has been relatively low in relation to. So that's a general context about, has the government thought about the interaction between the wee regulations, the forthcoming vaping products duty 2026, mm-hmm. and what we will hopefully move to legislate on this morning?
This is where I am going to have to bring my officials in, because obviously the wee regulations were put in place were around sort of like take back because of the rechargeable items as well. So now that these regulations have come in, there's not that take back responsibility. But can I bring my official on this specific point?
Yeah, and Michael, to Mark, who's been heavily involved in the wee consultation around the wee regulations, which we have consulted with the UK government again around the wee extended producer responsibility, which I think is what you're referring to, because there's already a collection requirement that's already in place. The key point here is about your point about the interaction of all of this. This is all interacting across the circular economy space to some extent, and absolutely there are interactions between the health stuff around a duty on vapes, our kind of wider things that we want to do around wee and EPR and other EPRs, etc., and the interaction with them. So, for example, around the wee, there was, as part of the consultation, it was highlighted that the dealing with vapes is much more expensive than all the other kind of wee, which is why they were thinking about creating a separate category for vapes, because obviously on EPR, the idea is about the producer pays for the waste cost, and the point is getting rid of a vape is much more expensive than other parts of wee. So that was in that consultation and part of what we may regulate on. The point being is that if, for some reason, these regulations weren't to be passed, then disposable vapes would be captured under that wee collection side of things, and the cost might be there to kind of deal with it. But and that will still be the case for the reusable vapes. But if these regulations pass and we take disposable vapes out of the question, then that interaction with the wee EPR kind of falls away. But all of these things, I absolutely agree with you that all of these things are kind of interlinked and kind of have impact on each other, including the duty on vapes, and that comes back to the point about if we end up with a cheaper product, would the duty push that to be more expensive and therefore less throwawayable anyway? But that's dealing with the reusable side of things rather than the disposable, which obviously is what we're here today.
I think I'm content with that. It is a complex area. I think the question is inspired just to make sure the government is live to the interaction between these regulations and the wider and other fiscal measures. So that's very helpful. I'll leave it at that, Convener. I think the terminology is dreadful. Wii, I think of a Nintendo Wii from several years ago, but I'll leave it at that, yes.
I think I'm definitely going to leave it at that. And Thank you. I think that's all the questions from the committee. So we'll move on to agenda item 4, which is a debate on motion S6M13568, calling on the committee to recommend approval of the draft Environmental Protection Single-Use Vape Scotland Regulations 2024. Just remind members that it's only them and the Cabinet Secretary that can speak in this debate. And I'm going to invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak if she feels necessary to the, or just to move this motion.
I'll move the motion, Convener.
Thank you. Is there any comments that anyone else would like to make? Can I just say at the outset, I think there's a lot of moving parts in these regulations, and I think we've heard from all committee members about the difficulties of identifying the different types of vapes, whether they're reusable or whether they're single use. And I think what concerns me more than anything else is the date. You know, the 1st of April next year, if everyone doesn't go forward with it at the same time within the United Kingdom, it would cause me grave concern. But I'm, as an individual, perfectly happy to support this on the basis that everyone is going to move forward on it. And also I would say that I guess that considering the points that have been made, it would be helpful for the committee as this legislation progresses and comes into force, that the committee is kept aware of how it's actually working and whether it's achieving the aims. So there's a general comment. I don't know if anyone else wants to ask the Cabinet Secretary anything they haven't asked already, or whether they missed to make comment. Bob, I see you've got your hand up.
It's just a very brief observation, Convener. I didn't think there was a comment I was going to be making, Cabinet Secretary, but I'd like to think commend the Government in taking a very proportionate approach to this, looking constructively for the four-nation approach to go live in April next year, and not rushing towards the need for a exemption from the Internal Market Act, that kind of four-nation approach in the first instance, for we all have a common interest, and I think that's just a good tone to set as we seek to engage with the new UK government. But that backstop measure of that exemption as and when required, I think that's the way to do business. So thanks, Cabinet Secretary.
Okay. I've got Douglas Lumsden. You want to say something?
Yes, just briefly, Convener, just also to welcome the Four Nations approach. I think this is the right way to go about this regulations. Only other thing I was going to add, Convener, if I may, and I think the Cabinet Secretary mentioned it herself, in terms of flavours and packaging and all that sort of area. And I know it's a problem for single-use vape, but I also think it's a problem for multi-use vapes as well. And I understand why it wouldn't fit in with this regulations. But I think going forward, I would like to see somewhere, maybe it's a health regulation or something, that gets addressed. Because I think you're right, in terms of the packaging, all the flavourings, it's targeted at sort of younger people. And a lot of the time we've heard, you know, about smoking cessation, how vapes are good for that. But I think often vapes, as we're seeing now, are actually being targeted just for people to go straight into use of that. So maybe going forward, it'd be good if the government addressed those issues as well.
Thank you. Deputy Convener, you would like to either ask a question or make a statement, because the Cabinet Secretary is going to get a chance to answer all the points that have been raised at the end of this debate, or during it, if she wants to.
No, just some brief comments in the same spirit as other colleagues have made. I do think that this is an important piece of regulation to get right, and if there's a need for flex on the timescale because of other governments, then that's absolutely the right thing to do. So I'm reassured by the Cabinet Secretary's comments on her proactive communications in order to seek that clarity. And I'm sure the Scottish Government will keep this committee and Parliament updated on the communications with the UK Government and the other devolved nations, and if there needs to be some change in the time frame, then to make sure a four-nation approach can be taken, then that seems like the sensible thing to do.
Thank you. Just looking around the committee. Cabinet Secretary, do you want to make any comments on things
just,
that you've
heard
this morning?
I really welcome the support, actually, for the intentions of these regulations, but also I welcome the support for the approach that I'm taking with regard to any flexibility that we might have to have should other nations not be ready. Don't know that for sure. But the point is taken. It's certainly my view as well. The concerns that the Douglas Lumsden raised actually are going to be addressed in a UK piece of UK legislation, the tobacco and vapes bill, around the sort of like the flavouring, the packaging, whatever. That's actually going to be addressed because it's you're absolutely right, Mr. Lumsden, that the people that have marketed them, let's face it, there has been a marketing attempt that's attractive to younger people. They might try the same thing with the more reusable ones, although I would suggest that they're harder to hide from parents, etc. But I'll just make that point. But it is actually, your points are being taken on board at UK level as well. We're supportive of that.
Okay, thank you. So the question then that we are at is motion S6M 13568 in the name of Gillian Martin be approved. Are we all agreed? Right. The committee therefore is agreed, and we'll report of the outcome in due course. I just invite committee members to delegate authority to me as convener to approve the draft report for publication. Are you happy to do that? Okay, I think it's fair to say that we should report in there as well the concerns about moving forward together on as the whole of the United Kingdom and the flexibility that's required. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Now, I think some of your officials are staying. I think there are some changes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow people to change, and I would ask everyone to be back in their seats by 11:30, ready to go. So I suspend the meeting. Okay, welcome back. We're going to move on to agenda item 5. This is consideration of another draft statutory instrument, the Companies Act 2006, Scottish Public Sector Companies to be audited by the Auditor General for Scotland Order 2024. Welcome back Gillian Martin, Acting Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy, who is joined by Andrew Mackay, the Head of Environment and Forestry Sponsorship, David McPhee, the Deputy Director of the Circular Economy, and Carolyn Boyd, a lawyer. Thank you all for attending. The instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means it cannot come into force unless the Parliament approves it. Following the evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion for the committee to recommend that the instrument be approved. I remind everyone that the Scottish Government officials will be able to speak in this debate, under this item, but not the debate that follows. Cabinet Secretary, I think you want to make a short opening statement.
I'm going to make it as short as possible. The committee will recall in the Circular Economy Bill deliberations when the amendments are lodged by the government to ensure that various pieces of legislation would apply to Zero Waste Scotland, Scotland's other public bodies will also apply to Zero Waste Scotland. The transition follows a decision made by the Office of National Statistics for Zero Waste Scotland be classified as a public sector organisation, as it's primarily directed and funded by Scottish ministers, and works well underway to ensure an orderly transition. And we fully expect the change of status, subject to what the committee votes on today, take effect from the 1st of October. Zero Waste Scotland will be subject to the same provisions on public finance and accountability as other public bodies in Scotland. And it's also important that Zero Waste Scotland is a designated accountable officer for the organisation as part of routine good governance. Zero Waste Scotland will not be part of the Scottish administration in terms of the Scotland Act 1998. It means that for the purposes of Public Finances and Accountability Act 2000, the Permanent Secretary, as principal accounting officer, cannot appoint accountable officer for Zero Waste Scotland, but Article 2 of the draft order requires that Zero Waste Scotland be audited by the Auditor General for Scotland, which then consequently engages the relevant provision of Part 2 of the 2000 Act. Where the body's accounts are subject to audit by the Auditor General, the Permanent Secretary will then be given power to designate an accountable officer for Zero Waste Scotland under Section 15, subsection 3 of the 2000 Act. I hope that that gives a summary of what we're doing. I am going to close there.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Convener. Secretary. Does anyone have any comments on what appears to be a good idea, Mark?
Just very briefly, Convener, just to say that I'm really looking forward to Zero Waste Scotland growing into this role. I think it's been a long time coming. And I think as an organisation, it's really going to drive progress forward in the circular economy. But to do that in a way that's fully accountable, and look forward to Zero Waste Scotland attending this committee as well in the future.
Does anyone else have Douglas?
Yeah, just to confirm, Cabinet Secretary, will this also mean that they are open for freedom of information requests as well at this point?
Already are.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, any other comments? If not, we'll move on to agenda item 6, which is the debate on motion S6M 13501, calling on the committee to recommend approval of the Companies Act 2006, Scottish Public Sector Companies to be audited by the Auditor General for Scotland, Order 2024. Cabinet Secretary, can I invite you to speak and move to the motion?
Moved.
Oh, perfect. Thank you. Does anyone have any comments that they wish to make at this stage? Okay, so no one's made any comments, so I'm assuming, Cabinet Secretary, that you don't want to respond to the debate or make any further comments. So the question, therefore, is that motion S6M13501 in the name of Murray McCallum, but supported by Gillian Martin, be approved. Do we all agree? We are agreed. The committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course, and I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve the draft report for publication. Are you happy with that? You are good. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for your officials. Some of you are staying with us for the next item. Are you all staying with us for the next item? No, there's a, we change over. So you can do the changeover while I introduce the item. Thank you for being here. Our next item is a consideration of a Type 1 consent notification for a proposed UK statutory instrument, the Producer Responsibility Obligations Packaging and Packaging Waste Regulations 2024. On the 5th of June, the Minister for Climate Action notified the committee of the UK SI. The instrument will involve the UK Government legislating in a devolved competence and is seeking the Scottish Government's consent to do so. The Scottish Government proposes to consent to this instrument, which, as the Clark Papers explains, would require producers of products to pay the full net cost of managing their packaging at the end of life. The committee's role is to decide whether it agrees with the Scottish Government's proposal to consent to the UK Government making these regulations within devolved competence and in the manner that's been indicated. If members are content for consent to be given, the committee will write to the Scottish Government accordingly. In writing to the Scottish Government, we have the option, of course, to draw matters to the Government's attention, pose questions, or to ask to be kept up to date on relevant developments. If the committee is not content with the proposal, however, it may make one of the two recommendations outlined in the clerk's note. We can recommend that the provision should not be made at all, or that the Scottish Government take an alternative legislative approach, for example, bring their own Scottish statutory instrument. I hope that's all clear. To help inform our decision, we've invited the Cabinet Secretary to stay here and to give evidence, and I'm not going to welcome you back again, Gillian, but you are here. We've also been joined by Scottish Government officials, David McPhee, who's doing a third tour of duty in his role as Deputy Director for the Circular Economy, Alex Brown, who I think is joining us for the first time as the Circular Economy Policy Officer, and Caroline Boyd, again on her third tour of duty. Thank you for joining us. And I'm going to move to questions from the members. And the first question, I believe, is going to come from Jackie Dunbar. Jackie.
Thank you very much, and welcome again, Cabinet Secretary. It's just a quick question to ask if the Scottish Government has been in contact with COSLA regarding this, and are you able to tell us if COSLA are satisfied with that, or are there any outstanding concerns that regarding the cost of recovery for the local authorities?
Absolutely, we have been in touch with COSLA throughout this whole process. I'm really pleased that they're bringing forward, that the UK Government are bringing forward these regulations, and I hope that the committee will agree that it's going to be a step change in taking the management of waste as being a burden on the taxpayer and a burden on the public money, and is instead a vehicle in which the manufacturers of the products are paying for the waste management of their packaging. I think it's going to do a number of things. I think COSLA is supportive of it. What effectively it's going to mean, UK-wide, £1.2 billion a year is expected to come to local authorities, and that will translate, obviously, with the consequentials for Scotland. £120 million a year is anticipated, maybe more, maybe less, but it's anticipated that will come to local authorities from the scheme administrator as a result of their handling of the waste packaging that they have to do. And what that initially very much can mean that they can invest that money in improving their recycling processes, and again, but crucially, not putting the burden on the council taxpayer or the funding that they get from government to be dealing with waste, because over time, I think initially there'll be a point at which there'll be two streams of funding coming, because they'll have to have a certain amount of adapting to all the waste management that we're asking them to do. But effectively, the money coming to them as a result of the EPR is going to help them significantly improve their waste management.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jackie. Douglas, I think you've got some questions.
Yeah, I was just going to double check on something that Jackie Dunbar raised. In terms of extra money coming in to local authorities from EPR, will that be additionality? And the Scottish Government won't look to try and rein some of that back in and reduce their block grant because there's money coming in from EPR?
So through the EPR, local authorities are going to receive the full net costs for managing packaging through EPR, taking account of efficient and effective service provision. And this could mean over time that the money that goes towards that the councils decide to spend on the waste management envelope is taken over by the funding that's coming from the EPR. So that will be decisions that how councils manage their funding. I'm not going to look into the future and say what the finance secretary of future governments is going to do on council settlements. I don't think you would expect me to do that. But the idea is that there's going to be this additional money is going to be coming from EPR, and then within the kind of like council's decisions on spending, that they may be in a position to release money that they would otherwise have been spending on waste management to other areas. Now, what that means for future council settlements, not something that I'm able to answer here and now, because obviously that's up to a finance cabinet secretary to decide in future. But that is the mechanism that's going to happen, because EPR essentially is about the producers having responsibility for waste management of packaging in this instance, but maybe in future there will be other regulations coming forward from the UK government that we'll hopefully be able to agree to that actually extends that to other types of waste.
But I guess from that answer, a lot of local authorities won't be getting too excited because they'll feel that extra money is going to be given one hand and then taken away on the other, because you can't really give them assurance that it's additionality.
Well, the thing is that you cannot give assurance about future budget settlements at all, Mr. Lumsden, as you know. So I think that I would be... I'm not in the position to say what is going to happen in future with regard to council tax settlements, but it's the fundamental principle that waste management is the UK as a whole and the four nations of the UK as a whole are moving towards waste and the responsibility for the paying of the handling of waste, not coming from the public purse, but coming from the producers of the items that we use. And I don't know if David wants to come in.
Just to confirm that point, I mean, the aim of this policy is not to pay local government to deal with waste twice. Not that you're suggesting that, but it's not about them having the money to deal with waste and then getting extra money to deal with waste. It's about the fact that the waste services will be for packaging will be paid for by the producers, and therefore they have the money, enough money to deal with that, because they have it through an efficient, they get the net cost through an efficient and effective service to deal with that, which means that broadly that means that the pressure is taken off the public purse to allow that money to be spent in other ways. Now, as the Cabinet Secretary says, can't say what future settlements will be, but the point is it means that cost will always be met by the producers, therefore taking that burden off of local government, and therefore the other fundings are essentially available for other services, essentially. So they're no longer having to look inside their budget settlement to say, well, how do we deal with waste of packaging, because essentially that's been paid for through the packaging EPR. So the idea is that the burden is taken towards the producers rather than the public purse itself.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'll move on to the... next question, and that's has there been any specific concerns raised with you by Scottish businesses or stakeholders about the impact of the EPR for packaging?
So I think initially, obviously, there were like a lot of questions around what it might mean for them, and there was discussion about what influence they had in the design of the EPR and what. What the administrator did was they put together a steering group, because it was important that businesses had an influence on how this was actually going to be designed. And of course, this is obviously a UK instrument that's coming to us to agree on. It allowed members of that steering group to perform an advisory role, and it
indicative producer base fees, they were released in August and gave businesses the sort of indicative accounts of what they can expect to pay per tonne under the EPR. I think that really these have been dealt with at the sort of like Four Nations level, because the business community has been involved in the design of this really from the get-go. And they understand that. And one of the things, Mr. Lumsden, I think it's maybe important to say, is that I'm actually really genuinely quite looking forward to seeing how businesses adapt and producers of goods and packaging adapt to this, because I think that what we'll see as a result of this is I think that we'll see our packaging improving. They will not want to be paying a lot of money in terms of the soft packet plastics, etc. I'm excited to see how this is going to develop, because I think we'll see a revolution and innovation in the way that packaging for our goods is actually manufactured and designed, because they'll be wanting to take away the waste plastics as much out of it. Hopefully, the fact that this is being moved across all four nations will mean that they see a market for better packaging for these producers. There's market opportunities there, but also the producers are looking at how to actually bring down waste at source.
Mm-hmm. And as you know, have we learned from other countries already? And has that behaviour changed and packaging changed?
So just to say that, I mean, Alex might want to comment on this because she's more of an expert than me. But the packaging EPR is not unique to the UK. There are packaging EPRs throughout the world that take this approach. Just coming back to the Cabinet Secretary's point about business being involved in this conversation now, obviously there are always talking about business in one homogenous group is very difficult. There are varying degrees of people disagreeing with how it's implemented. But broadly, we have engaged closely with the bodies that oversee producers to understand where they bring that expertise, because they all work in countries abroad. I mean, many of these companies are multinational companies, so they know how these things work and are fed into DEFRA and to ourselves and the scheme administrator. They're involved in the scheme administrator setup to make sure that best practice is brought in as much as possible. Obviously, within that, there's always going to be producers will want to go to X and government will only want to go to Y. So I'm not going to suggest that it's a position where we're saying we all agree and we're all completely happy. There's compromise in that within that conversation. But business are involved in the development of that scheme administrator and the policy generally and working with us. They do have, businesses have raised concerns about it being a public sector administrator, but that was part of that was defined by the way the scheme is set up at the moment. But conversations continue with businesses about how we can address that and look forward and make it more within line with other countries in that respect. So we continue to engage regularly with business, and DEFRA take the lead on that, but we do that at a Scottish level as well by speaking to the business organisations who represent businesses, again, to help understand how this can work most effectively for them. And I would say that most of the business organisations I speak to recognise why this approach has been taken, what they're doing. They might not agree with every element, but they recognise it, they're looking to respond to it, they're looking to innovate, and they're looking to move forward. So I think there's good engagement in that respect.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
There are a few other questions, which hopefully will be short questions with short answers. Sorry, Ben, I shouldn't have said that before your question came up. But Ben.
Okay, well, I think that much of what I was going to ask has been covered by Douglas's questions around engagement with business. So unless the Cabinet Secretary and our officials have anything more to say about engagement with business, I'm happy to move on.
Okay. Thank you, Ben. Sorry, Cabinet Secretary, was there anything you wanted to add?
No, I think we covered that comprehensively.
Mark, you had some questions, I think.
Yeah, I was curious about how this relates then to where we currently are with deposit return schemes, because presumably this also incorporates bottles and cans and glass. I'm interested in looking at that and getting your views on that, and whether, you know, you see an inevitability of a DRS across the UK in the run-up to 2028, or whether
or not? I mean, perhaps this doesn't apply. So,
I don't want to go completely into DRS, but obviously DRS regulations are going to be completely separate to this. One, just to get me on update, it's another area in which we're working very closely with the four nations with other three nations of the UK on this. We've obviously signed up to working with the UK government on DRS regulations very quickly. When the new UK government come in, I've written to them to sort of like, you know, reiterate our stance on DRS. But in terms of the interaction between this, could I hand over to my official, please?
So just to make one point clear, in EPR, in the packaging EPR regulations, DRS items are not included at the start for this, for the reason that DRS has to be set up by industry. So they'll be spending the money getting ready for DRS. So any items that are included in DRS at the moment are not included in EPR because, as I say, they'll be focused on that. However, there is a backstop, and I think it's the 1st of January 2028. There is a backstop that if a DRS is not up and running by 1st of January 2028, then all the items that are in DRS will come into EPR. Mm. So that's a kind of, yeah, it's an incentive, okay, to the businesses.
And can I make it clear that every single one of the four nations wants DRS to be up and running well before that?
Yeah. So just to be clear then, so no DRS, and then you have to pay through the nose for EPR post 2028. So even if you're a wine and spirits, you know, company, and you're using glass extensively, you may be looking right now at the lack of a DRS for glass and thinking, well, we've got out of that. But come 28, if there isn't a DRS for glass bottles, you would just be having to make a payment through this scheme to enable local authorities to do all the collection of your glass. So there's actually no way to kind of get away from paying for the cost of collection. It's just which mechanism you want to go through.
Yeah.
Is that a fair...
I think that's a fair assessment, yeah.
Okay. So what do you think is going to happen then with DRS, given the context now of EPR being brought in with this backstop of 28?
Well, that's something that obviously we've written to the UK government to reiterate. We'd already signed up before the general election to the previous government on what we were going to do. We were going to work in lockstep with the other nations in terms of rolling out DRS. Obviously, in the same vein of the previous discussion around vaping, I've been in touch with them about moving that ahead on a four nations basis. So I'll keep you updated on that, okay, but our position remains the same. We want a DRS,
okay,
working as soon as possible.
Great. And then my last question is really then just about the context of the draft circular economy 2030 route map and just, you know, when that will be finalised. Obviously, we saw in this committee,
yep,
an earlier version of that back in January, I think it was. Lorna Slater provided that to the committee.
Yep.
It would be really useful to know when that whole picture can be finalised and brought forward.
So we have, I think we're on record in saying that we aim to have that published by the end of the year. So okay, Nothing has changed in that respect.
Yeah. Okay.
Thanks. Douglas, I wasn't sure if your question was on this, because I know Bob Doris has got a question. If it's not specifically on this, I'm going to take Bob Doris next. Bob.
Mine is not on this either, I have to say.
No, but it can be a short one anyway.
Yes, well, I'm sure it will be, convener, indeed. So, £120 million per annum potentially going to Scottish local authorities from a system administrator to be appointed. That's a huge amount of money and it's very welcome. I'm just wondering, in terms of parliamentary scrutiny in relation to all of this, is the systems administrator, do you anticipate they would come to this parliament to explain how they've arrived at the breakdown for all 32 Scottish local authorities, to making sure they're getting an appropriate share of the pot of cash that's created across the UK, and what thoughts the Scottish Government given in relation to making sure that the data that we get and the cash that local authorities get will actually be accurate and appropriate for each local authority. I've got a wee bit here that says the SA will then distribute the funding to local authorities. It will calculate the net efficient disposal costs, in an assessment year, less partly because certain aspects are reserved. And it goes on. I won't go on, convener, but it could get quite complex.
So there's a couple of things I maybe want to say before I directly answer your question, is that one of the issues that we brought to the table when we were talking about these regulations was that a lot of our local authorities cover our rural
parts of Scotland, and that we do not want them to be disadvantaged over the urban ones in terms of that geographical. So we managed to get them a must change to may, that kind of thing in the regulations, so that they're actually taken into account when they're looking at the funding that they give as a result of the activities that's happening locally. They take into account rurality. Of, you know, Highlands and Islands Council are in a completely different situation to Glasgow City Council in terms of how they manage their waste and how so that adaptation was made in order to make sure that it wasn't disadvantaging a lot of, you know, rural councils. Welsh Government, I think, were very sympathetic to that as well for similar reasons. To your substantive point about scrutiny of how it is spent, well, obviously there'll be allocations that are given to council, so obviously we'll be able to scrutinise how that's deployed at council level. But in terms of the system administrator actually coming and giving evidence to here, it's going to be a UK-wide systems administrator, but I would say that it's probably good sense for them to engage with all four parliaments to make sure that they are scrutinised as much as possible. And of course, we will be wanting the data. Scottish Government will be wanting the data as it relates to our local authorities. That's going to be absolutely essential that we have that.
So, Ms McPhee, did you want to come in? Sorry.
It was just to confirm. So, we are working on this Four Nations basis, which is why we have one scheme administrator, which is obviously a benefit of doing this at the UK level. There's an efficiency of kind of ensuring that we have that administrator. There was regulations brought to this committee earlier in the year about the data that we need to collect around EPR, so you can see that there is a process in that space. As I say, my understanding, and again, Alex can correct me wrong, that the calculations, the underlying calculation, how it works, will be a public document that will set out how the calculations are there, so there will be that public facing ability to interrogate it. Obviously, to that point that the Cabinet Secretary made about us ensuring that we take account of our rurality and our specific points is something that we have worked very closely with the UK Government to do. So it's supposed to be as transparent a scheme as possible, but it is about that, and that we're still to get to the point where our local authorities will know what they will get. And under that efficient and effective calculation, so there will still be an engagement piece to make sure that we understand what that looks like and that we can test it and make sure that it's being calculated effectively.
I suppose the reason for asking the question, Convener, is clearly we can engage in partnership with local authorities with a bit of scrutiny work in relation to that. But I'm just wondering whether the quantum of cash available for Scotland has been agreed, because these will be businesses that will be levied across the UK. Amazon works internationally, for example. So, and whether the remote and rural weighting is once the cash has been established for Scotland and then it kicks in, or whether there's a remote and rural weighting at a pan-UK level, which would give Scotland a larger pot of cash to begin with. So those things become quite important. But also, if at a later date a local authority was to say, well, we don't think that we are getting a reasonable share of this pot of cash, for example, they might want to come to this committee and say, what can you do about that? So that's why I was asking about the scheme administrator. I think a future-proofing parliamentary scrutiny as much as anything, I suppose.
Just to add to that, it's a very interesting question. I'm sat here thinking about some local authorities who burn a lot of their waste because there's no other way of disposing of it, island communities, whether there'll be disadvantages as a result of this. It's a really interesting question. Cabinet Secretary, you got that about incineration not being disadvantaged. No, but I did.
Yeah, but I don't know my question.
So that's a level of detail I'm not sure I'm able to go in, but I want to answer the point that really it's about the costs of the dealing with the waste being met by the fund, not the other way around. It's not a case of, like, this is what we collected, so this is what you've got. It's effectively, this is how much it's going to cost us to deal with this packaging, therefore, this is the money that we require.
That's helpful. And sorry, just to be very clear, the 120 million is not a fixed figure, and neither is the 1.2 billion. I mean, that's just essentially kind of where the estimates are going. This is a process that still has to be going through, and it is that built up to what the costs are, and then the producers pay for that cost.
Can I just point out, I'm delighted that we'll be in a few years' time in a position to scrutinise all of this anyway. This is a really positive step, but I'm just thinking ahead about when there's such vast sums of cash, quite rightly, go to our local authorities. The Parliament will want to keep an eye on how that is being used, but also whether they're getting a reasonable share of that overall pot of cash.
Douglas.
Can I just ask briefly, in terms of goods that are imported into this country, will the importers have to pay this as it comes in, and is that how we have it on a level playing field?
Anybody that sells here?
Yeah, so anybody... So anything that any regulations in the UK, if you're actually trading in the UK, you're subject to the laws. So this is exactly the same.
So it's not just producers of products, it's importers of products as well that we have to pay. Okay, thank you.
Just wondering if there's any other questions for the Cabinet Secretary. I would normally suspend the meeting to allow you to depart, Cabinet Secretary, but we're going to push on because we've got quite a lot still to do. So what I'm going to thank you and your various teams and your long-standing members of the team who have attended all three sessions for coming this morning. And then I'm just going to... address the next part to the committee. This is really a question to hear members' views on whether the committee should approve the proposal. Does anyone have any views on this, or are we happy to approve it? I think Bob's point was really interesting, and it's something that the committee will want to watch in the future as far as the scrutiny of how that cash is allocated. But happy to listen to any comments anyone's making. No. So, if there's no comments, I could move to the substantive question for this item. Is the committee content that the provisions set out in the notification should be made in the proposed UK SI? Are we all agreed with that? We are agreed, and we'll write to the Scottish Government to that effect. Now, that concludes our public meeting, and we're now going to go into private session.